Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar, IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box, and it is also provided in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let us move on to the analysis of first news article.
Day before yesterday, that is on 24th July 2019, Lok Sabha has passed a bill, and this bill is Unlawful Activities Prevention Amendment Bill of 2019. This bill actually aims to amend, or in other way, alter certain sections of Unlawful Activities Prevention Act of 1967, or Prevention of Unlawful Activities Act of 1967. Actually, this editorial article is a response to the developments with respect to the amendment bill. That is, this bill was passed in Lok Sabha. The relevant portions of the syllabus that can be linked to or related to this particular article analysis has been provided here. Before entering into the analysis of this editorial, let's first know the reasons given by the Home Minister why an amendment was required for the UPA Act of 1967. It is said that the authorities in National Investigation Agency have faced certain difficulties in the criminal justice processes, particularly in investigation and also in prosecution. When we say investigation, we refer to the period from the registration of first information report, that is the FIR, till the submission of the charge sheet by the police after the completion of investigation. That is, when the police complete the investigation, they will submit the charge sheet. This charge sheet is also called as final report. When we say prosecution, this happens in court after the submission of charge sheet by the police. And this process of prosecution will end with the pronouncement of judgment by the court. The one of the difficulties is that the National Investigation Agency has felt that if investigations were done by officers at the level of inspectors, then there could be better investigation and also better usage of resources with respect to cases related to terrorism. And then another reason why there is an amendment is to align the domestic law, that is UAPA Act of 1967, with international obligations. If you have a look at UAPA Act of 1967, at the end of the BAR Act, you can see some schedules. There is one schedule called as Second Schedule. This schedule consists of 9 international conventions or protocols. So now the purpose is to align the definition of terrorist act with these protocols. If you see the Act, Section 15, Subsection 2 tells that an act of terrorism includes any act that will be constituting an offense that lies within the scope of or that is part of the definition given in any of these protocols or conventions or treaties as specified in the second schedule of UAPA Act of 1967. So how does the amendment bill aims to align the UAPA with international obligations? Now this is because it inserts another convention called as International Convention for Suppression of Acts of Nuclear Terrorism of 2005. So now let's see some of the changes proposed by the amendment bill. Firstly, it proposes to create a separate schedule called as Fourth Schedule. The purpose is to list individuals as terrorists under Section 35 of UAPA Act of 1967. As of now, there are only 3 schedules to this legislation, where the first schedule refers to unlawful associations or unlawful organizations that are listed under Section 35. We just saw the second schedule that deals with international treaties or conventions or protocols. The third schedule deals with identification of high-quality fake Indian currency notes. At present, there are only 3 schedules. And the mechanism at present under the legislation does not list any individuals as terrorists under any of the schedules. So it only lists the unlawful associations or unlawful organizations. Secondly, the bill proposes to amend Section 25 of UAPA Act of 1967. Here, the purpose is to change the present process of approval that is given by Director General of Police of a state government. This approval that we here refer to is for the seizure of property or attachment of property that has been used or obtained in relation to the act of terrorism. So the bill proposes to alter or include this process of approval to be carried out by Director General of National Investigation Agency for the cases that are being investigated by National Investigation Agency. Then the amendment bill aims to insert a new clause BA in section 43. This is to make the officers in the level of inspector rank to investigate the offences under UAPA Act of 1967. If you look at present, the investigation of the offences under the Act is being carried out by the officers in the level of deputy superintendent of police or above the level of DSP. This is with respect to areas other than metropolitan areas. In metropolitan area, the cases will be investigated by the officers above or equal to the rank of assistant commissioner of police. Even when the nomenclature itself within cities or metropolitan area, you can see nomenclature as deputy commissioner, joint commissioner like that, and commissioner of police like that. In rural area, you can find the designations or nomenclature as superintendent of police, deputy inspector general of police, IG of police like that. Then as we saw earlier, the bill aims to amend the second schedule to include International Convention for Suppression of Acts of Nuclear Terrorism of 2005 to align the domestic law with the international obligations. Now let's come to this editorial analysis. The author comments that the provision to list the individuals under the fourth schedule appears innocuous. Now that means this listing appears as if a provision is safe and harmless and as if the provision serves a very good purpose. But this appearance is deceitful, according to the author. The listing of individuals also raises serious constitutional questions, particularly if the individuals are to be listed before the conviction in any court of law, because this will amount to absence of judicial determination in the listing of individuals as terrorists. We know that in many cases, we have seen misuse of provisions against human rights activists, human rights defenders, and those who are having disagreeing opinions with the government. The problem is such listing will affect the right to life and personal liberty of the individual that is guaranteed or preserved under Article 21 of Indian Constitution. Till now, we have been only penalizing the individuals committing acts of terrorism under the Act, and we were listing only the unlawful associations or organizations. Now, in listing, if there is absence of judicial determination, then if the matter is taken to court, the court may simply strike down the provision for listing of individuals. This is what the author means by the invalidation of provision by the court. So, how an individual's liberty is affected by getting listed in the fourth schedule? See, absence of restraint is liberty. But we can imagine that anyone who are listed as terrorists will be definitely under arrest and detention. So this curtails their freedom of movement, their liberty. Then the author says that this provision is potential for misuse. So there is a possibility of wrongful designation of individuals as terrorists. See, this will cause irreparable damage to the reputation, the career, the livelihood of the particular individual. The author is in worrying tone here because of the statement made by the Union Home Minister. This bill was introduced in the parliament by the Union Home Minister only. The minister has been reportedly threatened the human rights defenders and people activists by allegedly referring them as urban Maoist. These comments were made with respect to the successful passing of this particular amendment bill in the Lok Sabha. So therefore, there is a fear that these provisions could be misused to list the individuals who raises strong voices, strong disagreeing dissident voices against the government. The author is saying that the addition of the provision to make the inspector level rank officers to investigate the offences will significantly enhance the scope of misuse of the provisions under the Act if this bill becomes an Act. The author also calls this bill as a non-federal bill. This is because as of now, with respect to the grant of approval for seizure of property or attachment of property, the power lies with the Director General of Police of the state government. Now, according to the amendment bill, this approval will be given by Director General of National Investigation Agency for cases investigated by NIA. So this means centralization of power. So this bill is non-federal in nature. Finally, the author concludes by saying that India needs tough laws to combat or to fight terror to show zero tolerance towards such terrorism activities. But while enacting legislations on this subject, the government should be mindful of its constitutional obligations to preserve fundamental rights. And there should be no scope of misuse whenever such laws or such legislations are enacted. And also there should be strong protective measures within the legislation itself against an authority who misuses the law. So now it has been passed in Lok Sabha. Let's wait till it being passed by Rajya Sabha. And then once the president gives the assent to this particular bill that is passed by Parliament, the bill will become an enforceable legislation. With this, we come to the end of this news article. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. This OPED article is about the Surrogacy Regulation Bill of 2019. Now, the syllabus that can be related to the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. So, what is surrogacy? Now, this bill states that it is a practice in which one woman bears the child and gives birth for an intending couple, that is, for a wife and a husband. That is what this bill tells. And this happens with the intention of handing over that child to the intending couple after the birth of the child. Simply, we can say one another woman carries the child for a couple and gives birth to the child. And after the birth of the child will be handed over to the intended couple. Here, that another woman who carries the child and gives birth is called as surrogate mother or simply surrogate. The bill also defines intending couple who can opt for surrogacy. Intending couple is any couple who have been medically certified as an infertile couple and who intend to become parents through surrogacy. These conditions should satisfy according to the bill. They have introduced this surrogacy regulation bill in this month in Lok Sabha. So the bill intends to facilitate an altruistic surrogacy in the country. So literally, if you take the meaning of the word altruistic, it means being selfless or showing concern for the well-being of others. So in the same way, altruistic surrogacy refers to those surrogacy agreements or arrangements where the surrogate mother does not receive monetary compensation. Instead, we can see here, according to the bill, the surrogate mother is a close relative who carries the child being selfless and for the well-being of the intended couple. And then after the birth of the child, the close relative will hand over the child to the particular couple. So the bill defines altruistic surrogacy as the surrogacy in which no charges, no expenses, no fees, no remuneration, or no monetary incentive of whatever nature has to be given to surrogate mother or her dependents or even her representative. So these are not given to surrogate mother. But there is one exception here. In altruistic surrogacy, the medical expenses incurred on surrogate mother and the insurance coverage for the surrogate mother is paid by the intending couple to the surrogate mother or her dependents or the representative of the surrogate mother. So now we understand that a surrogate mother has to be a close relative of the intending couple according to this bill. So what is the sudden need for regulation of surrogacy? Now this is because by regulating surrogacy, the government wants to put an end to the rampant or uncontrolled commercialization of surrogacy. So when we say commercialization, it means that something is being done only for the purpose of financial gain. In the same way, commercial surrogacy means commercialization of surrogacy services or commercialization of surrogacy procedures or its component services or component procedures. the entire segments related to it, application, whatever, till the birth of the child, everything will be commercialized. So this includes selling or buying of human embryo and then trading in the sale or purchase of human embryo or gametes. This means the human embryo will be a tradable product. And next is selling or buying or trading the services of surrogate motherhood. You know how they will do it? They will give by payment or reward or benefit or fees or remuneration or any similar monetary incentive. It may be given in cash or kind to the mother, surrogate mother or her dependents or her representative. We are using the words that are taken from the bill. So just remember that the medical expenses incurred on the surrogate mother and the insurance coverage for the surrogate mother is not considered as a monetary incentive or monetary benefit. So for all these purposes, the government wants to regulate this surrogacy and they want to end the commercial surrogacy because it is found that many underprivileged women are becoming surrogate mothers for the exchange of money. And some women are being exploited so much by the agents or the middlemen. And there were cases where surrogate mothers were not even given food or given good medical treatment. And there were no proper postpartum care. When we say postpartum, it is the period after giving birth to a child. So these are some of the reasons why the government was forced to bring this proposal in terms of a bill. The next reason to bring such a bill is to stop or to curb the fashion surrogacy. Fashion surrogacy happens when a woman opts for surrogacy just because they feel their body figure would be disturbed if they carry a baby. That is why the bill clearly says that surrogacy can be opted only when the couples are medically certified as an infertile couple. The statements about fashion surrogacy has been given by the two women personalities who were interviewed by the correspondent and based on which this open editorial article was built. Next, let us see some of the problems related to the bill and some of the problems with the provisions given in the bill. What they are saying is that before bringing the surrogacy regulation bill, the government should have brought assisted reproductive technology bill. ART refers to treatments and procedures that aim to achieve pregnancy. So far we saw what surrogacy means, but if we look into it medically, for surrogacy to happen, embryos are needed. For this, the intended parents should undergo in vitro fertilization, IVF. In this in vitro fertilization, the couple provide the egg and sperm and create an embryo through this procedure. This embryo is transferred to the surrogate mother for developing the child. So embryo means a developing or a developed organism after fertilization till the end of 8 weeks. Or we can say embryo is an unborn human offspring during the period from approximately the second week to the 8th week after fertilization. After this 8th week, the unborn human offspring is termed as fetus. This in vitro fertilization is an assisted reproductive technology that is commonly referred to as IVF. So IVF is the process of fertilization by extracting eggs and also retrieving a sperm sample from the couple and then manually combining an egg and sperm in a laboratory dish to form an embryo. This embryo is then transferred to the uterus. These embryos are cultured or prepared in various IVF laboratories. It is therefore, the authors are saying that before speaking of surrogacy, the government should have brought the assisted reproductive technology bill. If we have a look at the bill, there is a mention about donor eggs. So these are having a direct relationship with the ART procedure. Therefore, they are saying that the rules and regulations should have been formulated for ART first before bringing this surrogacy regulation bill. These donor eggs are actually the ones that are used for the in vitro fertilization procedures. There is also one another reason why this assisted reproductive technology bill should have come already. Now, first is that this IVF clinics have increased rapidly all across our country, and there are several malpractices being reported in such clinics. Some of the malpractices could be somebody else's embryo is put into the couples or surrogates, saying that it belongs to them only. And things are noted like these clinics, IVF clinics, are also advertising falsely that they can provide 100% success rate. By saying success rate, here we mean all the procedure related to IVF, finally handing over the baby in full health to the intended parents. The article mentions that the internationally acceptable success rate for women with respect to this procedure is about 35% only, and it can never be more than 40%. But there are certain IVF units claiming 100% success rate, and therefore more patients are going to them. There is also huge cost with respect to this IVF procedure being reported in several newspapers, and this article mentions that many IVF clinics now charge around 4 lakhs to 5 lakhs. So there has to be some regulation with respect to this procedure, and also to monitor, penalize certain malpractices that happens in this ART or IVF clinics. So that is why there is a need for ART bill before bringing the surrogacy bill. Now let us see next problem with respect to the surrogacy regulation bill. Now the bill specifies that the intending couples should be married Indian couples. So we saw in the beginning the definition for intending couple. Now there is a definition also given in the bill for the word couple. It means legally married Indian man and woman who are above the age of 21 years for man and 18 years for woman. The authors are saying that there is no mention of non-resident Indians who are working or studying abroad as of now and may be willing to come back home, that is to our country, to have a baby. The bill has left a lot of people who may want to have a baby through IVF procedure. It has left unmarried couples. It has left homosexual couples. It has left single men and women. It has left sexual minorities. Here, when we say sexual minorities, they are people belonging to LGBTQI community. And it is argued that surrogacy should be allowed when medical facilities are available for these set of population. Because if medical facilities are not available, they cannot have a baby. So that is why they are saying the bill should definitely include the sexual minority couples also, and also single men and women. See, this is one side of argument that has been represented in the news article. Now let's see one another problem that is expressed in the article with respect to the bill. That is, the surrogacy can be opted only by the couples who are medically certified as infertile couple. Now this means that the woman among the couple cannot have her own reproductive choice. That is, only if the couple is infertile can they opt for surrogacy. That is, they have to express that they are infertile. But if you see, Constitution gives a woman the right to reproduce, also not to reproduce according to her own wish. Along with this, a woman has right to privacy when she makes her reproductive choices. She need not share that she is fertile or she is infertile or not. In the case law, Justice K.S. Puttaswamy versus Union of India in 2012, the Supreme Court specifically recognized the constitutional right of women to make reproductive choices. This was recognized as a part of personal liberty under Article 21 of Indian Constitution. And along with this, we have a case law called as B.K. Parthasarathy versus Government of Andhra Pradesh, wherein in 2000, the High Court of Andhra Pradesh has recognized that the personal decisions about birth and babies are a part of reproductive autonomy. And to refer one another case law, Baby Manji Yamada versus Union of India, in this case law, in 2008, Supreme Court has explicitly recognized surrogacy as a method of reproduction. So they are saying that this clearly brings surrogacy within the reproductive aspect of privacy rights. That's why they are saying that the right to reproduce has to be incorporated into the surrogacy regulation bill. If a woman has the right to reproduce, this means that the woman can also hire a surrogate, and the woman can also go for IVF ART procedure. So the author argues that whether the woman is a transgender or a homosexual individual or a divorcee, the woman has this right. And here we have to note one thing, not only the woman who wants to opt for surrogacy has this right to reproduce, but also the woman who is willing to carry the baby and give birth also has these rights. That is, we are meaning to say the woman to become a surrogate mother, it should be based on her informed consent. And there should not be any element of force or coercion or influence. The next problem what the authors feel is that the bill allows only altruistic surrogacy. They are saying that this provision is very problematic because they are saying the women who are lending their wombs to bear children for somebody else are doing a job that is very creditable. And this is because they want to help somebody, but the authors feel that this does not mean that they should put their life on hold for surrogacy. That is, the authors say that they can be paid for it. And these have been mentioned by the authors because they find altruistic surrogacy has failed in various countries. And with the present provisions in this bill, to rely only on relatives for surrogacy, the relatives may not come forward to help. So therefore, the authors say that in the process of ending commercial surrogacy, the government has left a lot of women from the underprivileged backgrounds who wish to lend their wombs for surrogacy. The authors add that the surrogates are not very attached to the babies whom they are carrying in their wombs. This is because carrying the baby is just a means for them to get a livelihood, as they will be paid for it in a commercial surrogacy. That is why the name of the article is How to Make the Surrogacy Bill More Inclusive, by including these underprivileged women who have their livelihood dependent on surrogacy. For this, they also have suggested a solution. They are saying that the surrogacy should be declared as a kind of profession. A person who is providing a womb must have a contract that declares that the person must be paid properly, the person should get insurance and proper medical checks. The contract should also give an assurance that the surrogate mothers will be treated properly even in the postpartum stage, that is, even after giving birth. The next problem with the bill is that the whole bill has been drafted without taking any physical and emotional factors of the stakeholders involved in surrogacy procedure into consideration. And they are saying that there are many people who don't know whether they can hire a surrogate or not, according to this bill. Whether they will have a possibility to hire a surrogate or not, they also don't know that. And there are also people who have already hired surrogates. So what will happen to their baby after birth is also not clear yet. So there are a lot of doubts and confusions in various areas with respect to surrogacy, particularly after the introduction of this surrogacy regulation bill that we are discussing. And they are saying that if they are going to pass and make it an enforceable legislation without answering these questions and solving the problems that we have discussed, then there will be only chaos. So these are the opinions expressed by the authors in this article. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this OPED article. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This article is dealing with counting of VVPAT slips and the counts in electronic voting machines. So according to the facts shared by the Election Commission, there was a mismatch in counting of voter verifiable paper audit trail slips and the counts in electronic voting machine. So we know that VVPAT is an independent system that is attached with EVMs. It allows the voters to verify their votes about whether their votes are cast as they have intended. Now this VVPAT system is a printer that is attached with EVM and it is kept into the voting compartment. The printer prints a slip that contains the serial number, name of the candidate, the symbol of the candidate, and for whom the voter has casted the vote. This is the slip that the article mentions. The mismatch has been found in around 8 cases of recent Lok Sabha election. These were around some 51 out of 1.2 crore VVPAT slips that did not match with EVM. So they are saying that this amounts to almost around 0.0004% only. That is 0.0004% of VVPAT slips that did not match with EVM counts. Out of the 8 cases, the Election Commission has set up teams to inquire into some 7 cases. One remaining case was pertaining to Manipur, where they have filed an election petition, so the inquiry team was not set up. The election petition has been filed challenging the result in the Manipur constituency. The Election Commission has ordered the chief electoral officers to analyze the mismatches. It is said that the teams are given 10 days to analyze, and the orders actually cited a May 21 letter by the Election Commission where it has said that a thorough probe has to be conducted in case of a mismatch between VVPAT slips and the EVM count. That is, they will verify how many number of slips were available and how many number of votes were actually registered in the EVM machine. So this probe is to ascertain the technological errors, procedural errors, systemic errors, and also human errors, or whether any lapses in rules and regulations were there. And these errors and lapses also include possibility of not clearing the mock quotes by returning officers, and it also includes manual errors that could have occurred while tallying the VVPAT slips. Mock votes are nothing but the votes that are casted during the trial before the start of registering the votes in the electronic voting machine on the voting day. These trials are performed to show the booth agents that how the EVMs work and whether the votes are actually registered to the party to which the person has intended to cast. All these things will be verified in the early morning prior to official start of registration of votes in the electronic voting machines. So these errors and lapses also include the possibility of not clearing these mock votes. When returning officers conduct these trials, at the end of the trial, when everybody in the booth actually is satisfied that the electronic voting machine is working perfectly, that is when a person presses vote for candidate A, it has to cast the vote for candidate A only. After verifying all these things, they will clear these votes so that official voting process shall begin. If they have not cleared these mock votes, it will lead to errors and lapses. That's what they mean here. So according to the present electoral rules, if there is any discrepancy in the match between VVPAT slips and EVM count, the VVPAT slip count only prevails, not the number displayed in the electronic voting machine. And this is according to Rule 56 D4B of the Conduct of Election Rules of 1961. After this, the result sheet will be amended and the final result is announced accordingly. So with this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. This news article is about the role played by the heaviest rocket launcher in India, that is the GSLV Mk-III, in reducing the number of orbit-raising maneuvers. The syllabus that can be related to the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here. So on 22nd July, GSLV Mk-III launch vehicle has carried the Chandrayaan-2 spacecraft and has placed it in the Earth parking orbit. So we have been seeing in news articles that it has placed the spacecraft at 6,000 km more than what was originally planned. Now this means the apogee of the Earth parking orbit was about 6,000 km more than the originally planned system. It is said that Earth parking orbit is an orbit where the spacecraft is actually checked whether the entire propulsion systems and all the other systems are working properly and whether from here it can be moved to other desired orbit for maneuvering. The article talks about perigee and apogee. When we say perigee, it means the closest distance that is reached by an object from the center of the Earth during orbiting. And the apogee means the farthest point or the distance reached by the object from the center of the Earth while orbiting the Earth. The news article is saying, because the apogee of the Earth parking orbit was more than 600 km as planned, this has actually helped the spacecraft to reduce one elliptical orbit maneuvering, and thereby it has led to saving a lot of fuel that can be used for maneuvering around the moon or any other purpose during the travel. So now let's see few information related to this three-stage launch vehicle, the heaviest launch vehicle in India. In the first stage, the launch vehicle is launched by two solid rocket boosters. In other words, it's also called as two solid strap-ons. We can see the solid strap-ons on either side of the core liquid booster. And note that this is a solid propellant. These are called as S-200 solid rocket boosters. And in the stage 2, the fuel is a core liquid booster. This stage is called as liquid stage. The first stage is called as the solid stage. This liquid stage is actually powered by two Vikas engines that use liquid fuel. And the third stage is called as the upper stage. It is the cryogenic upper stage. Here it uses C-25 cryogenic engine, which is the largest cryogenic engine in our country. This engine uses liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen as propellant, And when we say cryogenic temperature, it means very low temperature to the level of somewhere between minus 150 degrees Celsius to minus 273 degrees Celsius. So this is about the fuel and the stages, that is with respect to this GSLV Mk-III launch vehicle. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now, this question is with respect to water verified paper audit trail. They have given two statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. First statement, it is a printer attached with electronic voting machine. Now, this statement is correct because VVPAT is an independent system that is attached with electronic voting machines that allow voters to verify their votes. That is, they can check whether the votes are cast as they have intended. It's a printer that is attached with EVM and is kept into the voting compartment. So the first statement is correct. Now the second statement, whenever there is any discrepancy in the match between VVPAT slips and EVM counts, the EVM count prevails. Now the statement is incorrect. Because according to Rule 56, capital D 4B of Conduct of Elections Rules of 1961, the VVPAT slip count only prevail whenever there is any discrepancy in the match between VVPAT slips and the EVM counts. So therefore, only first statement is correct and they're asking the correct statement. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is option A, one only. This question is with respect to Chandrayaan 2. It is the first mission from India to soft land on the South Polar region with lander Pragyan and rover Vikram. Now this statement appears to be correct. Well, the first part of the statement is correct. The second part is wrong because we know the name of the robotic rover is Pragyan and the name of the lander is Vikram. So the first statement is wrong. So you can easily arrive at the correct answer by elimination of option A, option B and option D because they all have statement 1. So a correct answer for this question is option C, 3 only. Now let's come to the second statement. They are saying with this mission, India aims to be the fifth country to soft land on the moon. Now this statement is incorrect because India is aiming to be the fourth country to soft land on the moon. If the mission is successful, India will be the fourth country to demonstrate soft landing on the moon, which is very important objective of Chandrayaan 2. Now the third statement, it was launched with GSLV Mk-III, the most powerful launcher till date in our country. Now the third statement is correct. So the correct answer for this question is option C, 3 only. Now let's see one mains question with respect to altruistic surrogacy. What is meant by altruistic surrogacy? Critically examine the provisions of the Surrogacy Regulation Bill of 2019. So first we can define altruistic surrogacy as surrogacy where there are no charges, no fees, no expenses, no remuneration or any sort of monetary incentive to the surrogate mother or her dependents or her representative. This is as per the definition given in the bill. But we saw there is one exception, that is the medical expenses and insurance coverage for the surrogate mother has to be paid by the intended couple. Now while examining, you can highlight the positives from today's analysis, that is the aim was to put an end to commercialization of surrogacy where we could see misuse of women from underprivileged sections and where we also saw there was the women were not given postpartum care, where the women were not given proper medical care when they were serving as surrogate mothers. And when we say commercialization, we mean commercialization of surrogacy services or surrogacy procedures for the benefit of financial gain. This includes selling or buying of human embryo, trading in the sale or purchase of human embryo or gametes. It also includes selling or buying or trading the services of surrogate motherhood by, you know, giving financial compensation. Now, one another positive with respect to the bill is that it curbs fashion surrogacy. When we say fashion surrogacy, we mean women opting for surrogacy so that their physical appearance will not be altered. How this bill curbs fashion surrogacy? Because the bill clearly says that the surrogacy can be opted only when the couples are medically certified as infertile couple. Now while examining, you can highlight the negatives. Particularly, we discussed that the government should have brought the bill for assisted reproductive technology before bringing this surrogacy regulation bill. The bill also failed to mention about non-resident Indians and unmarried couples and single men, single women, homosexual couples. They were actually left in this process. And we can say that the surrogacy here mentions that only for the couple who are medically certified as infertile couple. That means it compromises the reproductive rights of a woman, because we saw certain case law based on which we can say surrogacy is also a reproductive right. So a woman can opt for surrogacy as a matter of reproductive right. But this bill does not address those concerns. And we also find certain section of women, particularly in the underprivileged population, who carry the baby and give birth just for livelihood purposes so that they will receive some payment. So there is also huge demand from certain sections of population that the government has to regulate the commercial surrogacy rather than completely abandoning it, because they have felt it has not served as a very good example, or it has not served its objectives whenever the commercial surrogacy has been banned in certain countries. That is, these sections also highlight that altruistic surrogacy has not gained ground in wherever the countries where it was implemented. So these are the points that you can highlight while you are answering this question.
With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, share, comment and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation.